Martin Benedict Brophy was originally from Elmira, New York. He was a tugboat captain on the Hudson River. He met our grandmother, Mary McElwain Brophy, in Long Island. She was originally from Chicago. Their primary residence was 519 18th Street, Union City. The house is still there and in great condition. Our dad was born September 28, 1924, and was one of eight children. When he was 17, my father tried to enlist in the service, but his mother wouldn't sign the papers. She knew what was coming.
Very lucky on that boat. You know how they fed us? You got two meals a day. And you had to walk from in the line, walk all the way through this boat, through the stairs, up to the where the McGalley was. Mm-hmm. And you did it. You had to walk all day almost just to get two meals. It was an English boat, you know? The captain was English. Uh-huh. And they had, here's what they gave us. They gave us ice cold cocoa, an orange, and I ate everybody else's.
Well, you ate it because
everybody
you were hungry.
Was seasick.
But I mean, in general, do you get seasick?
No.
You've never been seasick
no.
in your life?
No.
Didn't the engine cut out or something?
Yeah.
Right.
Three days out, off Nova Scotia someplace. We took the northern route. We were in a big...
Where were you heading to?
England.
From?
From Brooklyn.
Oh.
And 3 days out, we were in a big convoy. Uh-huh. And it was a big battleship right alongside of us, or a cruiser, I don't know what it was. Mm-hmm. And then all of a sudden, the engine quit.
Oh.
The whole boat was vibrating. You could hear it. You know? I was way down in the hole. You went in the boat, they put a hatch over, put up these beds, put people in there, put a hatch over them. They just kept make layers with these bunk beds, like, mm-hmm. you know, they were chain beds. I was going up to mess. And I'm out on the deck. Mm-hmm. So some guy says, come here, soldier, come over here. He said, you're a deck MP. What your job is, don't let anybody light up a cigarette out here. Make sure no portholes are open. But until we get the boat going, you're going to be out here. So that's fine. It's better. I said, you better tell I was with a casual group. I said, you better tell them where I am because they look at me, you know? And he said, don't worry about it. So I was up there, and I found a place where the captain's quarters was on the boat. And I was sleeping in there.
Mm-hmm. Weren't you supposed to be watching stuff?
Huh?
Weren't you supposed to be watching things?
Well, I was off.
Oh, okay.
I was on and off, like on and off.
Yeah.
We had a 20-millimeter cannon, you know, on a boat. I couldn't knock down a fly. But they would come out and fire this thing and scare the hell out of everybody, you know. We broke down and we dropped out of the convoy. We're laying in the water. And the captain comes over the loudspeaker in a British accent. And he told them, don't worry, we have plenty of protection. We got destroyers all around. I'm on the deck. I look, as far as I could see, on the horizon, maybe 20 miles away, I could just see one little mass. That was it. We stayed like that for 3 days.
Yeah.
Finally, they got it going. It took us 14 days to get to England.
We're in Rutland, Vermont, and we got a flying B-17 that's going to take off in a couple minutes. And behind it, you can see the tail section is a B-24. Same planes my dad was in World War II. There's the pilot. That's supposed to be the number of missions, but that's not real. So we'll see them taxi off and take off. It's going to be fun. There she is, Dad. Tell me what you saw today.
Oh, we saw a couple of Liberator and we had a lot of fun here today.
Adios, amigos.
After basic training, our dad was assigned to the 356th Service Squadron under the command of the 8th Air Force. That's the 8th Air Force patch on the top of his left shoulder. He was a gifted mechanic, and that was his primary role while stationed in England. Due to the heavy American losses during the daylight bombing runs over Germany, he was pressed into service as a gunner on a Boeing B-17 Flying Fortress. He was checked out both as a waste gunner and a tail gunner. He loved the B-17 for one reason. It gave him the best chance to get back home to Union City. And that's all he really cared about. His favorite fighter was the P-47 Thunderbolt. That's a P-47 behind him in these two pictures. After the war, he returned home to Union City, and that's where he met our mom, Margaret O'Donnell. She lived one block away on 19th Street.
What about the day you met Nanny? Do you remember that day?
Yeah.
You met her through Joan, right?
Peggy was Joan's girlfriend.
Both dressed alike. It was the Bobby Sox era.
Oh, they had similar hairdos, too.
Yeah. And they had sandal shoes, brown and white, and they wore these raincoats, you know. It was the style, you know. And they were always in that. And I would see Peg. I'd be going downstairs, and Peg would be coming up, and I'd say, hi, John. Like, that's how it was. You know what I mean? So I finally went out. She had a boyfriend, and this guy across the street that I had grown up with, and I liked the guy, you know. I would never ask her for a date or nothing because I knew she was going with this guy. I hadn't seen Peg for like 3 years. And when I saw her, I couldn't believe it, you know?
She wasn't a little kid.
Oh, anymore. Good looking kid, you know? Peg was very pretty.
Yeah.
So one day, I'm with this girl, and we went down to Chinatown, to Angelo's.
Chinatown.
And we were laughing or something. We come running up the stairs like that. And they come running up the stairs like that with this guy, Richie Murphy, you know? And hi, Peg. How are you, Rich? How are you doing? And that was it, right? Through the grapevine, I found out that she wasn't going to see this guy anymore, you know? So finally we went to a dance. That's what it was. Down on Knights of Columbus. And Peg's aunt ran. I took her to the dance. Joan went with this other guy. We walked in the place and...
Joan was very attractive.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, sure. And her aunt, Aunt May, came over and said, oh, she knew me, Aunt May, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And I have a drink for you guys. And guess what the drink was? Manhattan.
Oh.
Peg never had one, and I never had one. We had a great time there. And it turned out that I really liked it. She was a good dancer, and I loved the dance story. She was a good dancer.
Everything was delicious. We're going to come back again tomorrow.
Yeah, okay.
I would sacrifice anything, come what might, for the sake of having you near, spite of the warmth.
because I've got you under my skin. And I dig you under my skin.
Our parents were married in 1950. They moved to the Lincoln Apartment Building in North Bergen, 7512 Park Avenue, apartment 22.
Today is December 11th.
Wait, she's gonna, hold on.
January 11th, 2004. He wants to know what Jim and O'Donnell is like.
Not his children. It was almost a, one of those boys. You know, he loved his kids a lot. Yeah.
My father-in-law, every time he come to the house, he was a painter by trade. Every time he come to the house, he'd say, oh, I'm gonna come up and brush this up, you know, or put paper this and stuff like that, you know? And at that time, we didn't have too much money, you know, just getting by. So he said, I'll be up Saturday, and I'll paint the bathroom and things like that. Come Saturday, I think we had about $2 to our name. So I went down and I picked them up, and we're coming up Kennedy Boulevard. And we go around a place called 49th Street, the boulevard turns like that. And right in the middle on the white line is a can of paint.
In the road?
In the road, upside down. No label, no nothing on it. I said, excuse me, Pop, just a minute. I pulled over, there was a used car out there. I pulled in and ran back. How do I let all the buses go by? I picked up the can, the car didn't say nothing to them. And I got all the way home, and I had some shellac. I was gonna let him varnish or varnish the hallway, you know. I told him, never mind the bedroom, let me have the paint. So I opened up the paint, and Peg wanted a peach bathroom. And this paint was peach. It was perfect. And he painted the bathroom.
And he never knew where the paint came from.
Never knew where it came from.
Oh, did you ever tell him?
Never told him. No, I never told him a thing about it.
While living in North Bergen, our mom and dad opened a small appliance and sewing machine repair store. Doreen was the firstborn and the one they loved the most. She went to school around the corner at Immaculate Heart. I got there as fast as I could in 1957. We moved to Richfield Park in 1960. In the late 1950s, our dad started work as a sewing machine mechanic for W.F. Bruce Incorporated in West New York. They made tablecloths. Doreen, Bobby, Lauren, and me all worked with him at W.F. Bruce and later on at Bardwell Industries in Hoboken. We loved being with him, and he was a great boss. We also loved going to Leo's for lunch. That was the highlight. A typical day in Richfield Park consisted of us fighting over the TV, not walking the dog, and breaking and losing things. This drove our mom crazy. Dad's main hobby was ripping the house apart and rebuilding it. He loved it. For the really big projects, he'd have me bring my friends over to help, for free. Repairmen and contractors never came to the house. We didn't even have their phone numbers. He did everything. After 7th Street, and in the later years, Lauren stepped in and with a careful hand, looked after Mom and Dad. She is amazing. My father's sisters all lived together in Union City. He nicknamed them the girls. Growing up, it's probably the house we visited the most, usually for Aunt Claire's birthday party or for Christmas. The finished basement was every young boy's dream. It had a pinball machine, a built-in bar, and Uncle Bill's rifle and shotgun collection on the wall. our dad really loved his sisters, and they adored him.
Your birthday?
No, no.
Hi, Dottie. Say hi. Dottie and Gus from Gutenberg. Nobody else, only about five people know that name of that town. We got Mrs. Gannon, your neighbor's Crow Street. Say hi, Mrs. Kickwell.
Hello, Tom.
He's lurking in the back right there, eyeing those deviled eggs. All right, we're still here. Things haven't changed too much. Bobby showed up. Okay, here's Pop Pop's cake. Let's see what it says. Happy 70th birthday, Dad.
You guys gonna help me?
Throwing his whole party.
It was my idea.
He made all kinds of food and went to all the stores. We couldn't have done it without him.
This party stinks.
This party reeks.
This party stinks.
And here's Tommy boy. Buddy, show me a karate move.
Tommy, that was a long time. I'm leaving.
Something I want to say from the bottom of my heart. Very sincere. What's the name of this person we're here for today? Mr. Brophy. Mr. Brophy, it was a great birthday party, and I mean that from the bottom of my heart.
He's a corny guy.
Rate him in corniness on a scale of 1 to 10.
He's a 10. He's off the scale.
Is he?
Mm-hmm. Here's Peg. This is the woman behind the man.
She's almost behind you on the floor.
She's almost in the basement.
Okay, that's enough of that monkey business.